But yeah, look at this. We're right in.
Picks we are into the picks and bans. So Jace being banned out by SK Gaming, actually. So not going to allow enemies to have that. Enemies the top laner for is actually renamed to Tons of Damage.
Of course he is. They love to change their names at the last second. So Tons of Damage will be going through. And Ladius, of course we see a Fizz ban because we never get to see Tabs play Fizz.
And Zyra being banned out. Zyra is one of those things, if you remember back to the qualifiers that we saw with Moscow 5. And SK.
SK did it as
they
well.
They did the Caitlyn Zyra, and it was so hard to stop. We didn't know how to stop it, and obviously they didn't know, and they've just banned it.
What Candy Panda and Niff were doing in the qualifiers was actually just totally devastating. There were 150 to 80 a lot of times minion scores, and it was just so much poke and so much disengage that, I mean, I was commenting that I don't know how you actually stop it. Zyra ban, obviously. Skarner was one of the most picked and banned as well during the qualifiers, but they just banned him out as well. So what are they going to go here with the first pick? Because, I mean, Lee Sin is available. The last time they had their first picks, I mean, going back to the actual qualifier when they went through one of their group.
So this Rengar, the Rengar Ben that's come out. I mean, is this, he's gone through two rounds of nerfs before this patch. Is this just purely pro player reaction to just knowing it? Or do you think he's still too strong for pro play team, pro teams?
Ooh.
Nidalee. Well, we saw Ocelot playing Nidalee a few times in the qualifiers.
Yeah, so that Nidalee is actually probably mid on Ocelot. But further, going back to Rengar, actually, I think there's a few things that Rengar adds to a team comp that are unique and strong and competitive. I don't think he's actually kind of a pub stompy guy anymore, but it's just a matter of you combo him with something like Orianna, and even at MOG we saw that. It's just the instant ball initiation coming in from pretty much anywhere. So that's what's so devastating about it.
So Lee Sin may get locked in here. It could be I'm So Fresh in the jungle, actually, could be running Lee Sin, or it could be enemies in that top lane. We'll see whether that one does get locked in or not. The teams, you know, they're coming into this one. Sometimes we see it, they've practiced and they've you know, they really know exactly what they want to pick. So normally the picks come pretty quick, but these are going pretty slow, Eclypsia. They still seem hesitant in what they want.
The bans did seem a little bit scattered in a sense, which might be throwing them off a bit. Obviously, the Fizz ban would be very targeted.
Yeah.
But then Jace and Rengar are both that have received heavy nerfs in the last patch, and they weren't, I mean, aside from the qualifier, none of these guys have really played competitively on these settings. So they're probably a little bit reactionary. And going in with Taric very early on, that immediately cues SK that they have to deal with a very aggressive lane, because you do not pick Taric unless you're looking to destroy the lane.
So we're just waiting to see what Arne and Kevin pick in there. And I'm trying to think back to the qualifiers.
Oh.
Whoa. Oh, and I nearly dropped water everywhere as well at the sheer thought of that.
Would have been a bad thing.
That would have been a bad thing. There's a lot of electronic equipment down here. That could have been an interesting start to the game. But so we've seen a drop, and we are on the live, as I mentioned. So could this be a case of delay tactics, or is this an actual problem?
No, I feel like it's an actual problem. We'll hopefully hear word of it. I mean, could have froze. Maybe they didn't have the pick. That's one thing when you are on live. Sometimes you have to see placeholder picks if they don't own absolutely everything going in. So
Nidalot.
Nidalot. AP Nidalot.
Yeah, it's a thing. It's now a thing. I mean, it's we were told during the qualifiers that he's actually been playing Middly. I've got to play Nidalee in that mid lane for quite a lot. Piri is the spec and Hercubot. Oh, Hercubot. Now I know who it is. So now I know who the spec is.
See? Now you can yell at him all the time.
Yeah.
I thought our spec is Piri.
I know both these.
Our spec is Piri.
Yeah.
The spec for Chips and Noir is.
Yeah. There's Hercubot and Piri. So Piri, now I know. See, I've covered him in tournaments. He came up and meet me earlier, but he didn't say it was Piri, did he?
No, they told me it was Piri.
Oh, they didn't tell me. Okay.
Well.
So Piri's going to be doing the specking for us, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, and now Piri's getting a lot of spam requests. This is where you need to turn on Piri. You need to turn on the bit where it doesn't come up with your spam requests.
Because you're done for now. You can hit that button as much as you want. The friends request will keep coming.
Yeah, you need to go to settings and turn that off, because that's just going to keep coming throughout the whole time now. You like having friends. Yeah, apparently so.
So
Piri's going to be doing the specking for us as I sit back in cloud lounge mode. You guys come back to us. These T-shirts, by the way, you can buy these.
I like them.
Tales of the Lane T-shirts. Mimid, Instalock.
I mean, I want more than mid.
Anyone that's started the game will be very much aware of this whole thing that happens. You know, the very first words that come out, Mimid or mid, just
Everyone thinks that if they call a roll, that means they're entitled to it.
I called it first. Yeah.
So clearly, they should be allowed to play mid.
It's a thing. It's what happens. So SK Gaming, you can see Minsik actually in the background there as the SK manager. Now he's kind of like the overall SK manager as well, because you see him with MC as well for the StarCraft 2 stuff. So he's been around the block for a long time with SK Gaming. Every event I go to, he tends to be there in some form. He was there in LA, of course. Now Eclypsia, I mean, I guess this is their second big tournament. They were at Paris Games Week last week.
Okay.
So they've kind of been around Paris for a week. So these guys should be prepared, should be practiced. They lost to Fnatic 2-0, I think, in the finals. I'm not sure if it was the finals. I'm pretty sure it was in the finals. But they're definitely there at Paris Games Week. So they're coming into this one, second tournament, maybe a little bit shook the nerves off, shook the rust off.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe, but coming up against SK Gaming, it's a big thing. Oh, it was Candy Panda that dropped. Okay. So Candy Panda back in there. Needle Deception Hotshot, we'll hear about this. Well, you know, he returned to top lane just so he can get Nidalee back again. I don't know whether he's actually played it yet.
He hasn't played it. No, he did play it once.
Oh, did he?
He played it during MLG, but it was one of the off-stream games.
Oh.
I think they ended up winning it. Seemed like some of the cool picks at MLG last week were the ones off-stream. It's like, oh, they're playing Hecarim and Varus.
We only did
like
four games
off-stream.
Great.
And they seem to be all the ones that people wanted to complain about.
Yeah, so if you have just joined us, ladies and gentlemen, this is the very beginning of Tales of the Lane.
About to get underway.
Yeah, semi-finals, both semi-finals happening today, mm-hmm. and the third fourth place playoff, and the final, all in one day. Stick with us the whole day. I know there's a lot of other action going on. If you've got two screens, feel free to get them open, but you know, you're going to have us on, because...
Yeah, well, how could you not?
how rude of you. How very rude of you. You know, if you're French, there's a French stream. You can listen to Ships au Noir. There they are on the bottom of the screen.
Oh, fancy graphic here. Look at this.
Just there's Noir.
Yeah.
There's Ships.
Well, SK.
SK's over here.
Eclypsia.
There's Eclypsia over there. Yeah. I like this little picture we got going
on. It's nice.
And you can even see the blue and the red team. So that's who's going to get the pick. So red team is going to be Eclypsia. So blue going to... I think they did a coin flip.
It looked like
they
might have had a headset issue or something, because they were swapping around Kevin's headset.
You can see Minsik's doing something with Kevin's headset in the background. There he is. Yeah, so you can see. He's like, you want this big headset? No, I want this big headset. They are... very strong headsets, let's put it that way. They're helicopter headsets.
Super soundproof, because initially when they were planning this, they needed to be completely soundproof because we might have been playing on zero delay spec, right? So they wouldn't be able to spy.
But I guess other than Eclipse, it's probably only Eclipse they couldn't understand. I don't know. I don't think Moscow 5 know French, I'm pretty sure. Trying to think of Curse, if anyone in there would know it. Maybe not. But then again, it's still off point. You got to hear
it's still
communications, regardless of the language.
Mm-hmm.
SK Gaming, they're all Spanish and German now.
I mean, you can always hear Ocelot yelling during the game, so it's a little telling.
That's how you'll know that things are going down, because we're going to be on a three-minute delay. If you hear
shouts,
it's either RNA or Ocelot.
Start your three-minute timer, and there's going to be a fight.
Yeah, that's going to be a fight, and it's going to go SK's way.
Yeah.
That's what you've got to assume. I don't know, I'm trying to think. Kuja used to be pretty loud, actually. Now I come to think of it. Kuja used to be a
Kuja
shouter.
Is a really loud player as well.
Yeah, so
that is for
Kuja's
sure.
a loud one. SkyArt is also here. He's going to be commentating. SkyArt is from, used to be on Cypher, IEM New York. I remember him. He used to be the famous Nasus player, I guess you could say. Famous Nasus top. He was at, obviously, the same tournament you played
in. He dominated that tournament with Nasus,
with
to
Nasus,
be fair. That
was
way
strong.
Back IEM New York.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Way back before Nasus was no longer used.
So Eclipsia, actually, in the Paris Games Week, finished 3rd/4th. They lost to GSU in the semifinal. And then Fnatic took the actual finals.
So
but
who the heck at GSU?
Oh, no, never mind. No, they finished 4th. That was the 3rd play. I was getting confused about it. Eclipsia lost to Fnatic in the semifinals.
And then they lost, yeah.
And then finished 4th in the tournament.
And then they lost to GSU, which sounds like a thrown-together team. GSU Gaming.
I can't even...
They went 3-0 in the group against Authority. And to be announced. And LDLC. Leaguepedia, you might want to update that one. We're back into the picks and bans, ladies and gentlemen. If you are just joining us, Jace Fierce and Rengar were banned out by SK Gaming. Zyra, Shen, and Skarner banned out by Eclipsia. Nif is not going to be playing Nidalee. It's going to be Ocelot in the mid, we think. We don't think it's going to be Kevin in there that's going to be playing that. Meanwhile, it's going to be Lee Sin and Taric going to be on the Eclipsia side. So let's see what the picks are for SK Gaming. This is about the position we got to, Jat. This is where we were at.
Right, so everything seems to be fixed. They're going to be coming with these next two picks. I'd almost expect them to pick their support right here because they know exactly where Tarek's going to be going. The risky pick here would be a Sona because you'd get the strength of her, but you'd be really, really scared in lane, and you leave yourself open. They might just go, I mean, Nunu is still available, and they love that, but they're going with a poke comp, so they will want to make sure that they can disengage fairly well. The poke comp that they did the best during the tournament, actually, was when they had a four-man team aside from AP Nidalee that was actually very strong in teamfights, so they'd really just poke just with the spears and then come in later.
That's not going to be...
Trundle did get buffs. He did get buffed for the first time ever.
Oh, wow.
People talked that Trundle had been changed. So his Q's less mana. He is a little stronger. I mean, still probably not, but the potential is there.
Oh, wow. Candy Panda.
No!
The Vayne Lulu lane.
He just...
trolled you. Oh. Literally trolled you with a troll.
The crowd is not happy about that.
Yeah. So, well, we could see Sona. Oh, the active game. Just click OK on that. That's all. It's all good.
That'll go away.
Good. It's all good.
It's something we've seen before.
Yeah. So, I'm guessing... who's going to be with Tarek? Is it going to be Ezreal? Ezreal got nerfed, of course, in this buff.
It didn't stop people from playing him, though. I mean, even in the qualifiers, they were just still spamming games on him. You don't have the same potential, but the long-range like poke gameplay is still there. Teemo Chance breaking out, though. And they could have Diana and get booze.
Diana's actually what Tamps has been playing. So he'd been switching to that, so I expect that's probably a real pick. Corki, Tarek, yeah, that's a legit pick, I think. That one could well get locked in. So it's going to be Heidel on Corki. Don't know why Heidel doesn't select Corki himself. Why you select Diana for Tabs, I don't know.
So Corki, Tarek is actually, it's a kill lane we actually saw more so back during IEM Hanover. It's something that Dignitas actually did back then. And they combo the armor shreds together, essentially. This is back when they went Black Cleaver on Corki as well, because the Tarek Shatter with the Corki Gatling Gun plus any extra armor shred pretty much lets you do true damage to everyone. And going up against something like Vayne, who's really defensive and kind of scared in lane, means they're almost forcing a lane swap at this point with that pick.
So they're picking him with a... they got a bit of a poke, but it's not quite a poke comp. I mean, it's a little weird. You'd have thought you'd have had Corki alongside Nidalee.
Hmm.
So that extra poke...
right, extra poke, long-range missiles.
You go for the long-range missiles, poking through from both sides, set them up, hit them.
But it's one of those things that they picked so well in the last few times they did the poke comp. It's the poke Nidalee with four strong members of the team. And especially, poke comps do tend to kind of drag the games and make them extremely long. So they might just pick Nidalee to kind of keep them at bay and then try to surround Nid with hyper carries, which they definitely do if they did Jax and Vayne with Cho'Gath.
This is entirely possible. And they have both been locked in. So it's going to be Jax in the top lane. So that's going to be Kevin up there. RNA in the jungle with Cho'Gath. It's going to be Candy Panda returning to SK Gaming. Is going to be on Vayne. Nif on Lulu and Ocelot on Nidalee. And it's looking like we may get a Renekton on that top lane. So enemies. So Renekton versus Jax, that makes sense.
That would be good. But the thing is, that is not what SK is going to want to do. Because if they're going to run the Vayne lane, however, it's like SK is going to be wanting the lane swap. So picking their solo right here is going to be something that is going to have to be able to deal with the two-man lane, because Eclipse is going to want a 2v2, but SK is going to want a 1v2, so they need to be able to swap fairly dynamically.
Renekton's okay 2v1, though.
Renekton is okay 2v1.
Yeah.
Once he gets there, like once he gets a few levels.
Yeah, a few levels.
The very start is a little tricky. And if they go with Renekton, they really have to win the game early, and they do. So this is very much a rush game for Eclipsia and SK for a stall. Very much.
So, they are the teams. As you can see, they're just going to switch themselves into position. So, Heidel will be taking Corki. He is the AD. Kucha's, of course, the support. Tabs in the mid on Diana. And it's going to be... so, tons of damage is enemies. Is going to be Renekton. And I'm so fresh, of course, in the jungle. Is going to be on Lee Sin. So, return from Lee Sin in the jungle. Something we probably won't see from Moscow 5 later on in the day.
I think we'll see some Lee Sin jungle from Moscow 5 later in the day. You said probably will.
No, I don't think they will.
You don't
I think
they will.
Be banned. I think it'll just get banned.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
That's a distinct possibility, I have to say.
So, oh no, it's I'm French. Poor Rachel. I'm French.
Oh.
I'm French.
They had that queued up pretty fast for their Nekton pick, I gotta be fair.
They wanted to find him, actually, for this, didn't they? They're doing a cosplay thing later on. You guys will get to see it later on. It's gonna be in French. We're not gonna commentate the cosplay. As much as, you know, I'm sure you guys would delight in his commentating cosplay.
I could analyze the costumes, and you could do the play-by-play.
Yeah.
And it would be
it's
great.
Coming out, looking spectacular. But isn't it also shiny? No, it's not going to be happening. That'll be in French later on, so you'll get to see it. We didn't get hold of Renekton. We wanted to get hold of him because, you know, it's the classic internet moment. I'm French. How did you make this costume? How long did it take? I'm French. Okay. Poor Rachel, bless her. She had a hard time with that one.
Yeah, so we are live, right?
Yeah, so
we have 3 minute delays.
If we can get back to it and look at the... you want to look at the profiles, look at the Runes of Masteries.
I would love to. So awesome, we got that back up. I want to check actually what the... Sorry, I want to see Ocelot's runes on AP Nidalee. So if we hop into his profile real fast. Runes, I think he's going to go with the full AP page like he did last time. And this is extremely... It'll come, I think. Let's try the Masteries. All right, let's go for Masteries first.
Okay, it's 10, 11, 9.
Yeah, that's curious, really. So he's got Magic Pen, he's got the full health from Veteran Scars, and then he's gone 9 utility as well for blue buff, so he's really not like full out AP, but he's just, it's just all, obviously all across the board, so defensive for the lane.
It's called Will Smith AP Melee.
It's a good name, and the runes are not, okay, we got him on this page,
awesome.
And that's his full AP page, so he's that's just all out AP, and he's not going for that in the offensive tree, but I guess it's just to get through the laning phase. All right, let's hop back to the other screen. Let's check out, I'm going to go really quick through Candy Panda. I want to see if he's done anything curious on Vayne. And he actually has went just 15 AD, flat armor, nothing crazy there. As we get spammed with friends requests. Mastery-wise, 19-11, so that's what he's pretty much always went. You get the Indomitable Mastery on the defensive tree so you can trade better in lane, which is something a lot of AD carries have done. Let's check whether Hadal has done the exact same thing on Corki on the other side. So if we go back to the spectator screen and check out Hadal's Corki. Let's look at his Masteries right off the bat. And he's also got 19-11. So for those of you wondering, I actually posted a tweet about this the other day. It's like, you should go with these Masteries if you want to play 80 carry, because that's pretty much what all the 80 carries do.
You've been giving advice on your Twitter.
I'm trying to give tips occasionally. Yeah. And his runes are almost identical to Candy Panda, except he's got Magic Resist flat instead of a bit per level. And he's got that one random flat AD blue rune, which I swear to you doesn't do anything, but everyone likes seeing the number change from 15 to 16, and they think it gives them the full AD. It doesn't, so they should stop doing that. But either way, those are the AD carry runes, fairly similar. And we're going to be able to do this all day, so we don't need to rush through them. We can go a little more in-depth with the runes and masteries, because every game we're going to get to check someone different. Because of the wonders of 3 minutes.
So if you want those tips, ladies and gentlemen, get onto Twitter. And follow at Riot Jack.
Well, thank you for the plug there.
You do give the give the tips out. I've been noticing this. You've been giving them out lately. And it's interesting, actually, you say about the 19-11. That's almost the same as you'll take with bruisers.
Almost, right, because you're still getting the lane masteries, which are so strong. And that's why the bruisers take it, because they like to be able to freeze the lane with it. And that's essentially just, I mean, keeping the lane outside the tower. Otherwise, the creeps just pound you down. And when you think about freezing 10 creeps and they're all hitting you 3 or 4 times, That's like 40 or 50 damage you just reduced because you took 2 points in a mastery. It's really beneficial.
Yeah, very much beneficial. So here we go. We're going to get into the game. As you can see on your screen, SK are going to be the blue team. It's going to be Nif on Lulu. Cho'Gath is going to be Aranea. Kevin, as we switch in there. Kevin is going to be on Jax. Ocelot on Nidalee. And Candy Panda is, of course, on Vayne. That's going to be the bottom lane combo. As we get a slight screen shake there. Hopefully that's not on the stream as well as you guys.
I'm getting a little distracted.
Yeah, we do have French in our ear. It's nice.
That is happening.
Yeah, I mean, it's lovely to listen to French ladies talking, but not potentially in my ear while we're streaming. So let's see. All right. Are we going to have anything level one engage? Who would really be the one that want to fight here?
I'd say that it's going to be Eclypsia because they're very much the early game team. They're very much the team that has to win early, and they also have Taric at level 1, which would just combo so well with stuns. Even Corki can scout bushes if he decides to pick up Frost for Spawn. So they're very much on the aggressive,
SK,
and you can see SK's turtling
in. If you get a Taric now, please, you can see SK are going to jump Kuja. Oh, I thought he was going to go all the way up. They sometimes put the ward a little bit deeper, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
But he only went gently there, and SK were ready for that one.
What happens very frequently, at least in the games we're watching, is they go all the way to the Wraith to put the brush there, and you could see SK was ready for that.
Yeah.
Obviously, Eclipsia didn't do it themselves, and they might go for a delayed invade on the red here, which would be clean, seeing as RNA is up with Cho'Gath. Looks like he's going to try to do a blue start.
Kuja's going to be the face checker. Put the pink ward down to start with, actually. So full vision ward there. Going pink ward. You want to press S, by the way, Piri, so you can take directed camera off. That's what you're looking at. because I can see it in the bottom corner. It's trying to turn back on.
It's going to take us direct to camera very quick. But anyway, they're going to try delayed invade. They know there's no vision here. If Candy Panda pulls this in the wrong direction, no, they're actually going all the way around. They won't be able, they would have been able to pick up a kill at double golems because of the way they pulled it, but instead it looks like they're just going to get red.
Oh, you're going to see I'm So Fresh coming in. Actually lands the Q on Aranea, forces them away. They're going to get the red here, I think.
Ooh, they can get collapsed on by four, and they only have four here as well. They're going to have to back off.
And there's Niff, put the ward down. They managed to catch them. The rupture goes down, catches on towards I'm So Fresh. I'm So Fresh has to back away from this one. They got the red hitting them at the same time. They're going to fight for this one. They want it. They're not going to give this one up easily. Heidel's taking a lot of damage there. Does manage to turn it. The rupture hits the entire team. Eclipsia.
Aranea
is going down very low. The ignite's going to be enough. He should go down. Is there going to be a heal coming through? That's going to be first blood. It's Tams that picks it up.
Niff's
taking down very low as well. You can see Heidel, one more shot, gets the kill. And Heidel picks up a second, and now they cannot fight for that red, and Eclipsia starting off very well.
That is so huge. RNA losing his buff and dying. He's going to be far behind on Cho'Gath, and as well the delayed invade. Let's even look at who those kills went down to, and it almost couldn't be more perfect because Corki and Diana both picked up kills exactly who needs it. They don't have the advantage right now because they haven't shopped, but if they continue to win the lane before they get the shop, then they'll be able to snowball this.
So just... going across, you can see Ocelot leashing Aranea there. So let's go through the lanes, Jack. We talked about it earlier. It's going to be Jax versus Renekton in that top lane.
So Jax versus Renekton is a lane that Renekton has to win early. If he lets Kevin get going on Jax, he's going to lose pretty badly. You can see he's already got the lane shoving, and they know the gank pressure from Aranea is pretty much non-existent. So tons of damage on Renekton. He'll be able to just keep that pushed up. You can see he's already hit level 3. He's going to be in pretty good shape up there.
Yeah, so in the mid lane, you can see it's going to be Nidalee versus Diana. That's Ocelot versus Tabs. So we've seen Ocelot playing Nidalee quite a few times, and we've seen Tabs playing Diana quite a lot as well.
And this lane is really going to be about Ocelot just kind of stalling out and trying to farm. He's never been able to get super aggressive on Nidalee, as we see a failed gank up top on Renekton. So he's really just waiting until he gets a whole bunch of AP so he can poke down. His team's going to have to worry about losing the game before then, though, especially with those two kills they gave up early.
Yeah, sooner or later, Piri is going to press that S key on the keyboard to take it off direct to camera so it doesn't go automatically back to it, so we don't switch around the lanes. But down the bottom here, it is going to be Candy Panda. So they want to keep Candy Panda pressured as much as possible here because Vayne just needs to sit and farm slowly.
And this is a lane that I was a little surprised SK decided to put themselves straight into. Everyone going bottom, not trying a lane swap, and just trying to run Lulu Vayne against Terra Corki is really dangerous. And you can see, especially with the first blood that got handed to Niff in the jungle, they're already a little bit far behind. That's 8 minion kills to 18. And with Heidel getting 2 Doran's Blades right away, they're going to come back and just destroy Candy Panda and Niff if they play this right.
Well, I'm So Fresh was sat for a while in that mid lane. Now he's heading towards Jax, but you can see there's a ward there already, so he's going to get spotted. You can see that Kevin already backing away, so nothing going to come from this one. So a double buff Lee Sin really wants to find those ganks early on.
He's sitting Aranea
mid,
dead on a ward, and yeah, Aranea's coming in mid.
Yeah, he's
aggressive. Diana.
Tabs has gone deep. He's going to get caught out. Going to get silenced away. The rupture wasn't happening. Tabs actually went aggressive, realized that Ocelot couldn't join him in that fight, and forced him away.
Yeah, that's a lot of trouble for RNA because that's a gank top and mid
lane.
They had to ignore.
He managed to get him towards Niff here, got the Dazzle actually onto Candy Panda, but they backed away, and instead they've kept the pressure on. And this is what we talked about just a few moments ago, the pressure they're going to keep on this bottom lane.
And RNA is going to try desperately to stop this, but he's just a level 3 Cho'Gath, and I don't even know if he shows up, but they'll be going to be get it in because he's coming in behind, and this will be a gank, but Candy Panda might go down.
He might go down before he even gets there. He cleanses it off. Oh, the one more shot from Heidel came through. They will take Heidel down, so it's going to be a revenge kill for Aranea. Not too sure how the assists go out there. It will go quite well because Candy Panda picked the assist up, so he's going to get something out of it, but honestly, I'd rather just not die.
And that's still going to be issues, though, because that's 1,900 gold onto Corki and only 1,200 onto Candy Panda's Vayne. And especially with that death, even though they shoved the turret, he's still pretty far behind in experience, just level 4. Ninja Tabby, though, once again being picked up by Heidel. And that's something we saw in the qualifiers, and then we've yet to see replicated by any other region. But a lot of these European AD carries love going Ninja Tabby early.
Yeah, and it's interesting we've seen that, because honestly, in terms of differences between boots, not a lot has changed between Elise and Kha'Zix patch.
No, none at all
has
changed.
But last week at MLG, we just didn't see Ninja Tabby at all.
It's one of those things that only this region has picked up, and it's about trading really early. You saw with the Masteries, 1911, it's just more trade damage. It's just allowing yourself to be better with that. And when you consider, look at the bottom lane matchup, double Dorans and Ninja Tabby versus single Dorans on Candy Panda's Vayne, and that's just trouble.
It is trouble. We just saw Tabs having to poke towards Aranea again there, causing him problems. looking towards the levels, you can see they're pretty even at the moment, so nothing major going on. Jax has got a slight level advantage over Renekton, but it's only going to level itself out as soon as they both back off. Looking in this bottom lane, let's have a look towards the CS. You can see mid lane, actually. Tabs is really out farming Ocelot right now. 49 to 37, definitely got an advantage, as well as Heidel. Heidel, of course, just gone back. Like you mentioned, he's got Ninja Tabby and Double Doran's Blade, so he's a long way ahead because he picked up those two kills and the assist earlier from that invade. And you can see Renekton there, enemies trying to freeze the lane. I'm so fresh, ready and waiting to go on towards Kevin. And Kevin is actually slowly pushing forward. They may well go for this gank here, Jack.
Yeah, this could be trouble. Kevin's going to get stunned on right away.
He does go straight in. You can see he manages to catch him down. He gets the ignite down. He's going to get the Q, dodges it nicely, and avoids the damage. Very well played by Kevin in that top lane.
Just time to counter-strike right away, and the big escape there was in dodging the Q from Lee Sin, so pulling that up allowed him to escape. And I like that we're still going bottom here, because this is a big trouble lane. Candy Panda actually doing a pretty good job holding on, in all honesty, getting these minions at the tower, but you can just see there's no real way they can trade back and forth. They're still going to be in a lot of trouble that lane.
Still 10 CS behind. We just saw Ocelot go back, actually, as well as Diana. Diana's gone back, got himself double Doran's and a blasting one, so he's very much fed up. You can see he's got that only 8 CS advantage, but he got that kill and assist early on as well. So all the gold, obviously you can see that gold difference in the top of your screens, just that 1.5k difference. I'm so fresh, tracking Aranea through the jungle, which has bought time to actually come down. Did he steal the blue there? Did enemies at the top lane, did he get in? No, the blue hadn't come up.
He was just warding it.
So he's warded up that blue, so look for an invade coming in there. Oh, there's a big stack going down towards the red buff right now, on towards Aranea. Aranea's in trouble.
Oh, no.
He's going to get caught out. Hasn't used his sight, just used the silence, actually. Atelalai flashes out. They're going to continue on. He is a dead, dead Cho'Gath. He's going to get taken down. Nidalee comes down. Ocelot cannot do enough here, and Ocelot actually eating a beam as well. And they're all having to back off. Look at this, the bottom lane, they are just getting fed in between it. They're so careful. Diana's coming down the bottom. If you look towards Candy Panda, you can see having to dodge out of the damage here. They really are struggling. Eclipsia on a full aggression tilt here.
Yeah, and they're just trying to keep Candy Panda completely off the minion line. All four of them are invading the jungle here. You can see Ocelot's trying to scout them with traps. Catches out I'm So Fresh, but they are having issues dealing with this pressure.
The three-man stack down the bottom. They're going to go for Dragon instead. The ping's already gone on towards the blue buff as well. Dragon is not showing on the screen. It's there, though. It is there.
I guarantee
honestly.
You it's there.
I guarantee you it's there.
Yeah. It's not anywhere, I'd imagine.
It's not on either spec. Yeah, not on either spec. So
they're going to get it, though.
They're going to get this invisible dragon any second now. There he goes.
There it is.
Hey, so the invisible dragon goes down. So Ocelot is going to be picking up blue buff. You can see enemies moving towards it, though, but it's already gone. The ward was there. He was just too late. But, you know, taking a dragon over blue buff, pretty good trade.
And especially because they got all those kills with the red steel. They had both buffs warded because you could tell they were planning on invading something, but they pulled off the successful invade in red and capitalized off that. Wow, the damage.
Getting chunked down there. The ignite put on him as well. Kuja using his shatter and dazzle. Heidel just exploding on him. And he is really forced back, so he is struggling this bottom lane. He's 20 CS behind now, Jack.
And he's also pretty far down in experience, I imagine. It's six to six, but you can see he's going to be losing more. And Nif, still being level 5, doesn't even have that wild growth ultimate from Lulu. So, again, having to constantly shop.
Going to dive in, pops the moon call.
Moonfall.
Moonfall. Moon call, moonfall. Pretty much the same. Just one letter difference. But he is, and you'd see, you know, Ocelot is really struggling in this mid lane as well. He can farm quite heavily with Nidalee. We saw it actually against Akarthus. He outfarmed it? I think he was.
I think so.
I'm pretty sure it was Akarthus he outfarmed, but at the moment, you can see Tabs on Diana having a session in this mid lane.
I think a lot of this has to do with jungle pressure. When RNA lost early at level 1, lost the red buff, he just has not been able to pull off any successful ganks. And even in the world, that's one of the things that RNA, I mean, any jungler, but RNA especially, seems to struggle with a bit. Once he falls behind, I haven't seen him successfully get himself back into any of these games. He's kind of wandering around over-ganking despite them being unsuccessful. As we get Colorblind Mode swapped on here, it's going to be total catch-up for him this entire game, because all the lanes, including Renekton, Diana, even bottom, are just pushing up because they have no fear of his Cho'Gath ganks.
They have no fear, but so it's looking like Eclipse, they're definitely up in two lanes. Oh, and you can see Ocelot getting dived on there, but he's quite happy to fight this one. Oh, he's going to come full tilt.
Whoa.
Tabs might come off worse on this one. This could be a double kill. Ocelot's going to survive through it, but Tabs is going to go down. It's a one-for-one exchange. Nearly managed to survive. Pop that heal on himself, but wasn't quite enough.
That was a very surprising play. And again, coming into Kevin.
Has to cleanse it off there. Tries to keep it away. Actually, wasn't his cleansing. Zulti just used there. And Kevin goes down. Went too deep on Renekton just as he went aggressive. And the tilt is definitely on for Eclipsia here. 6-2. They're going to really have to turtle back into this game.
And compared to the first gank where Kevin was able to dodge the Lee Sin Q, couldn't do it that time, and it cost him his life. Big trouble here in the bottom lane. That's a giant creep stack. And they would be able to dive, potentially, Nip and Candy Pan off this turret if they go.
And they realize that you can see they're going to go for Nip. They're going to actually get the dive onto him. Pops his ultimate. Is it going to be enough to turn it around? You can see Candy Pan are keeping the damage on towards Kuja. Heidel taking low as well. Top turret has gone down while all the action happens there. That's getting Lee Sin and Renekton sticking on that one. And, of course, the mid lane of Ocelot is down, so they are completely trouble-free. Oh, that's a really good slow on towards
Ocelot's here.
And Ocelot does come down. You're going to see Candy Pan going down. Is it enough? Kuja's going to get taken down very low. They need to get a return kill. Ocelot trying to get the pounce on. Misses, dodges around. Very well juked out by Kuja. Kuja knows he's going to go down, uses his ultimate, buys time for Heidel to get away.
Overall, a fairly well-executed dive there. They're continually denying Candy Panda, really keeping him down there. A full phage ahead when you compare those 80 carry items. And you look at the gold just in that bottom lane, and it's 2,600 to 4,200 just for those 80 carries. Really across the board, all of their lanes are winning, even in middle. With Tabs versus Ocelot is 1.1k difference. So there's big struggle all around from SK, and I really think it just all channels off that early level one, and RNA's pressure has just been failing.
So we're going to start moving to mid game. You can see obviously Eclipse are definitely going to be stronger right now. They're going to have the pressure coming through. But looking towards late game, Jat, I mean, who's going to be the stronger? Obviously, Jax. Oh, they're going to dive on towards Ocelot. Ocelot's going to be able to pounce out of that one. Tabs going full on aggression. They're going to put the pressure on towards his mid lane. Candy Panda is going to come around and try and join them. RNA is getting dived on, but he's gone a little bit deep there. I'm so fresh. Used his ultimate, and it's not going to be enough. Now Tabs is going to get, oh, beautiful stun on towards the where the tower used to stand. Tabs realizes he's going to go down, tried to go aggressive, tried to get the kill on Ocelot. A little bit too greedy, a little bit too deep.
That was much too greedy for Tabs. He did not need to dive back in there, and giving that kill back is really beneficial for SK because everyone was there to soak up the experience. And now they're trying a delayed invade because they're low from the fight. They need to turn something around here because this is that early game team comp that Eclipse has picked. They've gotten the early win thus far. They need to hammer it home.
They're going to try and take away this red buff. SK really aren't in a position to deal with this one. They could rotate around to the bottom lane, which it looks like they're going to do. There's a big stack going in towards that. We already saw the towers taken down to about half health. But there is Candy Panda and Nif. Are they going to try and fight this one? I'm not sure they'd be in the right position. You can also see Kevin might get caught out here.
Ward.
Here comes Kuja. There was a ward. He does manage to get the dazzle down, but he got the stun going. Is it going to be enough? Kevin is going to get dropped on the turret here. A good dive from Eclipse here and really are pushing the advantages. And they have a stack towards the middle. They could go to the mid turret. They could go to the bottom turret. Candy Panda and Nif are kind of out of position here. You can see Candy Panda's going to get the free farm in that bottom lane. RNA did not want to go near that one. Ocelot's doing his best to keep the minions away, but honestly, I'm not too sure they can hold this one.
No, especially because Candy Panda is doing his best to keep up his farm in the bottom lane, so they have no AD carry presence with the rest of their team here. They did manage to repel it, but it's still not an overall save. They're losing all their buffs. They've lost all control, really, of the game here, and they're going to have to get a turnaround team fight at some point.
Yeah, and I think because Tabs have gone top, they just backed away. But the farm difference, as you can see, Abyssal Scepter, Athena's and Holy Grass between Diana. Oh, Ocelot catching a spear on towards Heidel there. The spears will start doing a lot of damage. Still only got level one boots in there, though, Sorcerer's Shoes. You can see the spears. This is what's going to turn things later. The poke comp is there. Candy Panda, they cannot allow to free farm not to catch up because, you know, Heidel built up such a great advantage, and now they're letting free farm.
It's really just a matter of Eclipsia keeping their advantage here because they've kept everyone down thus far on SK. You can see that Candy Pan is really far behind a Corki. Even Kevin's been held back on Jax. He's down 20 minion kills as well as two deaths and a Sunfire Cape rush by tons of damage on Renekton. Even Ocelot just finishing his Athenes on Holy Grail 16 minutes in, not really building anything else. Everyone on SK is behind, but you just look at the combination of the team comps and SK is all about late and Eclipsia is all about right now. So with the Dragon respawning again, they're going to have to go find a team fight around there. SK is pretty much going to have to give it to him, and then from there it's going to be about Eclipsia trying to find fights and trying to force SK down.
And they're going to do a four-man because they're going to have to deal with Jax. Jax pushing that top. Jax heading down the river now. He's just going to ward up the Tri-Bush. Jax and enemies are actually going to meet in that top lane as well, so they do manage to see each other. Meanwhile, you can see SK bailing, poking back and forward. The Dragon, of course, going to Eclipsia. And Kevin quite happy to fight this one. He knows it is a straight at 1-1. He is a level behind, and items behind as well. Sunfire Cape on enemies there. Enemies, aka tons of damage on your screen.
I'm going to call him tons of damage.
It's enemies.
That's his name.
Yeah, okay.
He changed it. He can lose his. He's going to get called tons of damage.
I feel like I'm shouting freak every time. Yeah, every time that comes out. But as it is, I'm so fresh. Going back, warding through. And we've got French again in our ears.
It happens.
We are in France, so it's inevitable. If only you guys could hear this. It's beautiful.
We actually see Diana coming around the bottom here. Gets stepping on an Italy trap. The turret is still up. They really need to take that turret. No, he's diving right in.
Absolute fantastic crescent strike from Tabs there. Tries to get blown backwards. Tabs is going to get dropped on the turret. Really good turnaround there. The Lulu ultimate followed by the rupture just completely kept him pinned.
It was a condemn, a Lulu wall, a Cho'Gath knockup, and a silence. It was just, he went in. He could never even pop the second instance of his ultimate, which would have bursted out Candy Panda. He had to wait. Like, they actually have to do their best to take this turret down, because if they're going to want to create pressure around the map, they have to get those tier one turrets down all across.
Superb stuff. They still have to have a three-man presence in this bottom lane to prevent Heidel Kuja pushing the lane. There's the rupture going down with the boombox of the... I'm always a gentleman Cho'Gath fan myself, but you can still see the pressure going down. They've got to be careful they don't get countered here. There's only a 2v3. I know they're very confident and Kuja really putting the pressure on, but the level difference is still pretty even between them at the moment. While this is all happening, you can see Jax is trying his best to catch up the farm. Renekton's just pushed away, but that's going to get caught straight up. You can see Kevin going back towards that top lane. He's just going to farm that wave out. While all in the middle lane, you can see Diana's been roaming so much that Ocelot's actually caught up.
Yeah, and you can really see that SK's almost paused the gold lead, because it was like 18,000 to 12,000, and now it's 26 to 20. So the last 8,000 gold or so, they've been trading even.
There we go.
Here comes another maybe dive, but they're really babysitting that bottom lane, trying to keep that turret up.
I think they're finally giving it up. Yeah, they've realized there's a four-man stack on this bottom lane. They're going to back off, and that is going to be Eclipsia picking up the third tower of the game. Chasing on towards RNA. RNA is going to get pressured here. Tried to get in and force the issue on I'm So Fresh on those golems, but he has taken it away. Ocelot's just lingering, but Kevin is keeping enemies constantly under pressure in his top lane. He can't leave that lane, so he's keeping it as a 4v4. They're going to possibly dive, put a bit more pressure on. I don't think they've got it in them to dive. Here comes Ocelot, so then spears are going to be coming through at the moment, so Heidel's got to be careful he doesn't catch one of those. And there it is, hitting Tabs. And it's going to keep the pressure on. Just saw, actually, I'm So Fresh diving on, getting out of the way of that rupture. And avoiding the damage.
If we can get back to the items, actually, you can just see the huge difference between both the teams and how they haven't been able to push on this advantage yet.
Condemn
and they just keep getting caught.
The Kuja getting caught there, and that was that. This is the combo you talked about. You got condemned on the wall, ruptured straight up, the spear on him. It's the easiest spear you could ever throw. Mm-hmm. Just completely pinned him, and that has forced the whole of Eclipsia just to back off.
And looking up top lane, Kevin really hasn't done much to hold back Renekton. It's just, with the Sunfire Cape rush, surprising, Renekton hasn't been able to put that much more pressure onto Kevin, because finally he's pushed this lane up to the side. But really, it's just going to allow Kevin to farm with the turret and not really grant him any big advantages.
Kevin, well, you know, what does Jack do? He farms. And once he starts coming into late game, he is a deadly, deadly thing. But Renekton can be strong late game if you let him farm, which he is doing. 171 to 134. That's still a big CS advantage. 138 to 94 across the AD carries. That's a pretty big advantage. Looking like Heidel slowly building towards the Trinity Force. Has he just gone back? He's just completed it. There's the Trinity Force. That's a big, big difference between
That's
him
huge.
And Candy Panda now.
Candy Panda not even made his Phantom Dancer. So just looking at the gold, there's multiple members of Eclipsia that are above 6,600 gold. So 6,700 on Renekton, 6,700 on Tabs, and 6,600 on Heidel. And you just look at SK, and no one's really close to that. The closest is Ocelot at 6,000, but then everyone below that is below 5K. So it's really... Even though they've stalled it out, they're still far behind, and there comes a dive.
Yeah, dive from Tabs there. Starting to get very aggressive. I'm So Fresh, actually can start taking those spears now. Put a normal magic mantle out there, and he's still eating the spears. You don't want to keep doing it. Kuja's going to clear out that ward. Spears continue to go through. They've not been able to keep that poke comp going, though, because they need to be the ones pressuring.
And at least they do have some good disengage and counter-initiate going, because you can actually see with the Vayne pick, even though it doesn't make much sense in the context of a poke comp, every time Eclipsia tries to engage in on them, he's using his condemn almost immediately and very often getting stuns, which they can chain in with the rest of their skill shots. So even though it lost the lane really badly, if they can continue to stall, I can see it actually working in the actual teamfight phase with those knockbacks.
And this is the thing, and you can, well, Heidel, just see how much damage is being done with one of those spears lands. They can farm this out. RNA actually, on Cho'Gath, can stall out the lanes pretty well without rupture and silence. He can just wipe the wave out once he starts getting strong enough. And then obviously Candy Panda just picks up the pieces.
that could be really effective. And you can see here with still the 6,500 gold advantage, Eclipsia, wow, the spear onto Kuja takes half of his health, and Ocelot doesn't even have a death cap. And with all this, they were down here trying to force, but Kevin's still pushing that top lane and will most likely get that turret.
The spear is now on Kuja. Ocelot, this is what it is. Now he's got that needlessly large rod and the Athenes. We've seen it so often. And but he might get dived on. There's the moonfall. Golden Brick in. Is he going to be able to get away with it? The rupture went down. They do catch him out. They sniped him off. That ward doing a good job. He tried to snipe him off as much as possible. That may be the mid turret they've just lost, so off the back. And immediately you can see Kevin is trying to get it. Kuja's getting pinned here. Candy Panda popping the ultimate. He's going to try and get away from this one. You can see he turns it around. He can't trade with Heidel right now because he's got that Trinity Force. Kevin has had to come back. He sees back to where he took the top turret, though, so they did pick up a turret. That's not a bad trade. One turret for one death.
When Ocelot dies and they didn't really get anything out of it, once they get the dragon, it will be a little bit better.
Yeah.
But still, trading all that farm onto Kevin isn't necessarily a great deal. Everyone on Eclipsia, even though they're strong now, those champions don't scale all that well. So once again, they really have to push this. You can see they realize that there's a BF sword now on Renekton, and it's just not much power, really. They don't have any aura items yet. They need that to dive. They need someone with a lot of armor so they can take turrets, because they really have to be able to get on SK and drive it home. They might try a Baron Force here, because this is one of the great ways of starting a team fight as the war cheers come through. But this is going to be the issue for them. Poking in and around Baron, SK is going to do a great job keeping them off.
Yeah, they're not going to be able to engage once with everyone alive there. And you can see the spear still going back on. I'm so fresh. Ocelot's doing a great job at landing these spears as well. He's not. And immediately you can see they're going to have to disengage. They're going to go deal with that top lane stack. So this is where SK is going to try and push advantage. They realize that someone's going to go to that top lane. So they're going to try and 4v5 stack it in this mid lane.
And now they realize with all the spears, this is the poke trying to come through. The strangest thing is they're down 7,000 gold. But if they have enough ranged poke and ranged engage, they're going to be able to pull this off. As long as they can disengage, it's going to be about Tabs trying to go in and create with
spears from Ocelot from the
with
side.
His vacuum, but they see that tons of damage is up top on Renekton, and they might be able to poke down this turret.
Yeah, and I'm so fresh. You can see that Tab's trying to catch on to him. They're going to keep the damage going. Kuja eating another one. Heidel trying to push that wave away. He's got to be careful. He doesn't go too aggressive. And Ocelot has to disengage. They realize Renekton had joined back down the bottom there. So they do back away. There's a really good wards, though, from Eclipsia. They have good vision across the board, across the jungle. So you can see they know exactly where, and someone's trying to sneak around. Ocelot tries to sneak around the side. They know his exact position. They have to keep that position up. They're going to try and pin Lulu out here. Nif has been caught out of position.
Man.
You can see Kuja's going to cut across. He needs to go directly left now. Clears out the ward, and Lulu's going to get away.
They didn't chase him through.
They didn't follow it through. Are they just going to clear the wards and maybe go Baron?
They might. This is the issue where SK is going to have to poke back or at least force presence elsewhere. They're going to have to push mid or just no, but Eclipse is not even really going straight for it. They're just falling back.
Well, okay, so if we're looking at the team fights right now, you'd assume Eclipsia are the stronger because they've got that items completed. If you look at Candy Pan, they've still not got that Phantom Dancer on there. Not really got a great deal of damage to go with it either. So they'd be in the stronger team fight right now, but they don't seem to want to force it.
By far, they have the stronger team fight, but they just don't know how to force it right now because they have to go in straight with Tabs. He's really the only one that can force something on. Kuja might be able to get a stun off, but every time he's looking around, Ocelot's chunking him back with those spears. They have huge creep stacks in their side lanes. You can see the bottom turret. They're losing a whole bunch of experience there just with that late wave hitting the turret. They could even lose the tower to creeps, and this is just a classic stall tactic by SK. Eclipsia is not able to engage. It has to be with the Taric stun, or Tabs has to fly in, but they're not really tanky enough or confident enough to make that play.
Heidel returning back to that mid lane, just trying to keep it busy, trying to keep them away. You saw that Ocelot and Kevin had gone in there, trying to get a little poke in it, but again, they've not had to deal with that. And that top, like you say, that bottom lane may well go down. It's down very low on hit points. The minions are going to finish it off, so there goes the turret. Minions take it down, and it's 3-2 in turrets. So despite this very much early pressure they've had, the 7k gold difference or 6k gold difference they have, they're not turning it into anything as the wards continue to fall.
And these guys are relentless.
We started something dangerous in LA. You realize that?
Oh dear, it's gonna go on.
It's a thing now.
Ever.
So as it stands, they need to stack up. Eclipsia, what are they gonna do with it? They have this advantage, this pressure. SK very much know how to deal with it. They're farming it out. 25 CS, honestly, in the grand scheme of things, between Jax and Renekton, is not a great deal right now. But now we're talking in the 200 figures. And even the AD carry, you can see that Candy Panda is actually starting to catch up.
Mm-hmm. And you can see 6,000 gold advantage has been stuck there for about 15 minutes because at the start of this game, it was something like 18,000 to 12, and the difference really hasn't moved, which just means, relatively, SK's been coming back farther and farther. And even though Eclipse is trying to force, they haven't been able to even get close. The poke from Lulu and the Cho'Gath wave clear is just stopping them from going on turrets, but they saw RNA was top, and they might go for this turret here. SK might fight.
There we go. They dived in. It's Candy Panda they managed to target onto. Gets the Lulu ultimate. They're turning around. Tabs might go down tight. There's going to be RNA getting dropped eventually. Tabs was taken very low. They went very, very deep there, having to use the ultimate, and they didn't manage to get the turret, though. So all they've got out of that is one single kill. Candy Panda's gone back to base. He's going to come back fresh. And wow, losing just the jungle. It didn't have an Oracle on him.
Oh!
They might get the turret now. Tabs. Oh, taking low there. And of course, that trap actually does damage as well.
Yeah.
So it could have slowly ground him
and
down.
And it lowers his resistance a huge amount, too. It just makes those spears even more potent. And they're going to have to keep trying to push on here. They're going to have to get something. And with the flashing away, there's the Condemn.
There's the Condemn. Candy Panda has to back away from this one. He's going to get taken very low. Heidel's trying to do it. Kevin blocks off the damage there. They do manage to take Candy Panda down. They turn it around. Jax is having to jump away. So Kevin trying to avoid the damage. He wanted to go across the side there. Can they continue? Can they chase this one? I'm not sure they're in a position to. Jax, yeah, Kevin is going to go deal with that side lane. Slowly but surely, it's kind of working for Eclipsia, but it is tentative.
This game, even though you might tune in right away and see 40,000 gold to 32 with 11 kills to 5 and 4 turrets to 2 and think, man, these wards are going down, this game is over, but it's so ridiculously close right now. 2. Oh my.
Oh my lord. It's become a thing and it's going to carry on. It's, you know what that is? That's an educated crowd that all watched the World Finals.
Yeah, it's true, actually.
You know, considering the time these were on, I mean, we talked to Chip Sanoa during it. Like, we were having a long day, but we were at normal midday. They were at, like, 3, 4 a.m.
All the way through to 9 in the morning.
As was everybody else in Europe that were probably watching this stream. These guys all had a long, long day when it came to watching this. So these things...
Die-hard League of Legends
these
fans.
These are the die-hard fans right there. So they're very much educated on it, and everybody's enjoying it. But... the game in hand.
Yeah, here comes maybe a Baron Force. This is something Eclipsia has to do. They've been falling back and back, and they're really needing a fight. Whoever wins a big team fight might walk away with the game, but SK's disengage has been so, so strong up until now that Eclipsia has to get a Baron or a team fight win here.
And Heidel's been doing a fantastic job of actually keeping them away, keeping the bait off there. The spear's coming through, missing, and that's going to be Kuja clearing out the ward. The Baron down, taken down. If we can have the Baron selected, please, so we can keep seeing the hit points on it. It's taken very low already. You can see there's going to be the rupture. Here comes SK. They're going to go for a bit. They're too late. SK Gaming do manage to back away. Can they disengage? Have they got the damage? Tabs is going to get dropped. It's a one-for-one exchange right now. RNA has gone down. Ocelot's going to avoid the damage. They're trying to disengage. Nif might be taken out here. He's been warded. Yeah, he's been slowed too much by Heidel there. But the rest of the team did disengage very well, and they picked up a kill from the main AP, taking the Baron off him.
And now that they have a 4-for-3, they really want to push this wave right away before RNA and Nif get up, because that's actually the main proponent of SK's wave clear is the Lulu and the Cho'Gath. So if they can get in and take this inhibitor turret before Cho'Gath gets up, they really need to get it, because once they come back, they might not be able to get the creeps to the turret.
There's creep wave coming in. Is it going to be enough? The spear's coming through, not really landing anyone. SK Gaming don't want to get too close to this one. They may lose the first inhibitor turret. It's almost certainly going to go down now. There we go, but they can't get the inhibitor. They're still not quite strong enough. There is, you can see, as you say, Aranea back up. They did lose Nif. Nif had an Oracle on, so they lost quite a bit to that, plus the fact that the gold advantage went to it. But SK had to fight for that.
And that's still a huge win for Eclipsia. They finally pulled SK out of their shell and got them into a team fight. The big thing was once they got the Baron, SK stayed and fought, which ended up losing it to them. And this is, I think, the fourth dragon that's coming through onto Eclipsia. Three real ones and one invisible dragon. But 30 minutes in, finally breaking through that 6,000 to 7,000 gold advantage and actually opening up something around 11,000. They might get something here. But mid lane, SK's trying a counter push.
Very much. Strong counter push. Let's have a look towards the mid lane. Please. Not enemies. Mid lane. There we go. First turret does go down in the mid. So that is all three outer turrets now SK managed to pick up. But Eclipsia, of course, with those five turrets straight up that mid lane. Haven't taken the inhibitor yet, but it doesn't matter. They did manage to get the important turret. So that's going to really cause problems for SK's stall. I expect Eclipsia probably going to go back by with that Baron buff, take another push.
And they're going to... yeah, right. You're right. Down the middle turret is the most logical thing. You can see fairly defensive builds coming in from almost everyone on Eclipsia. They're kind of looking to end. What Moscow 5 likes to do a lot of times is when they're looking for their final push, they'll always start building towards Guardian Angels. And you can see Enemies has it there on Renekton with his GA. You can see I'm So Fresh has the Chain Fest. Hadal has the Chain Fest. They're going to be looking to finish off those Guardian Angels fairly quick. They have double Aegisaur already, so it's a very tanky team they've created, which means they really have to initiate hard in on them because Ocelot Spears with the Death Cap now will poke them down. And if they take too long to push through, they're going to lose so much health that they can't fight.
So you can see that at the moment, I'm So Fresh is trying to split push it down, so he's trying to keep the pressure on towards it. So I guess we may even see the rotate round and take the bottom inner turret rather than push it straight for the inhibitor. Hydra's dodging out, clearing out every bit of the jungle they can. Lee Sin had actually gone back, so they're not going to keep pushing that way. The middle inhibitor is exposed, of course. They did just take it down a second ago, so I'd be surprised if they don't go straight for that one. They do not have Lee Sin with them at the moment, though. So despite the fact they've got the wave stack in there, it's just going to get cleared out very quickly. Yeah. Spears coming through, wards going down, cheers coming out. But as it is, SK going to hold and stave this one off. Level-wise, you can see they are starting to fall behind, slowly but surely, pretty much a level across the board from every lane.
And this really is a matter of getting the Spears to land. Ocelot has to get these down to dissuade them from fighting. There goes the inhibitor, and here comes an engage.
Tabs goes in, it was Candy Panda was the target. He does manage to catch onto him. Niffy's going to get dropped. He had to use the ultimate himself there. Rupture catching the whole team, but it's not enough. SK going to have to disengage from this one. The Spears coming through, landing on enemies, not enough. The inhibitor goes down. They might try and finish it right here, Jack.
They got a couple of them low. They know the Lulu ultimate's down. They're really pushing in hard. This could be huge.
This could be a dangerous play, though, for... They are do manage to catch it. That's going to be Kevin going down. That's the rest of the team should fall after that. Aranea's taken down. There goes another one. And that is surely going to be GG for Eclipsia. The big cheer comes out, and they have managed to take game one here. And that is a really big start for Eclipsia. That's going to settle the nerves against SK Gaming here at the Tails of the Lane. They are live on stage, of course, facing off with each other. This is a big win for them.
And we saw SK was the only team from their group to make it through.